Muldoon Elder, and my profession is a weird thing that you don't see too often. It's called being a painter or being an artist. And I moved to San Francisco and have been living there since 1962. When I was very young, I had a cousin who was an artist, so even though I had a yearning to paint, it would be too threatening, and he had the family position of being an artist. But by the time I was 16, I just said the hell with it and started drawing and then started painting. And I was maybe 23 already. Three or four museums had my paintings, so I thought, hey, maybe I could make a profession out of this. And I did so. Halfway through college, I realized that although mathematics was great to teach logic, that logic was wonderful, but something much more, much deeper, I think, was emotion. And mathematics had relatively little to do with emotion, but art did. So I thought, well, I know I'll starve for a while, but why not take that path? And I did. I was inspired by a lot of artists very early on. I think of course, Van Gogh, Degas, and Georges Rouault. And Rouault himself was a brilliant painter who painted in a kind of Renaissance style for a while. And he went to work as a young man in a stained glass window factory and started realizing that colors glowing through those black lines were fabulous, and started painting that way. And at first people said, what the hell is this? This is a bunch of crap. But then somebody finally said, hey, wait a minute, this is brilliant, this is innovative. And so when I saw it, I sort of went through the same thing. And then I realized, oh my God, color and line alone, without even representing anything, can be just fabulous. So those are probably the three people that were heroes of mine. I don't think about subjects. I think about the paint and what's happening on the canvas. And the subjects, if there's subjects, it probably has to do with portraits. I make what a lot of people call psychological portraits. Also, if I'm painting in a figurative way, I'm very, very interested in dance. So faces and dance, probably. Also, in a very abstract way, landscapes would, if you wanted to say, subjects. But I'm more interested in what's happening aesthetically than figuratively. Oh, I have favorites, yeah, so yeah. That's what you mean. In the very early 60s, a painting called Suspended Dancer that looks like a dancer on tow. Until you look more closely and you discover that she's actually on a rope swinging and her soul's leaving her body. So there's a lot of movement going on. And there's some paintings that are abstract landscapes. One of them's called Descent of the Ganges, another is called Azulau, that are particular favorites of mine. Lately I've been painting more of what you might want to call the geometric series. I wouldn't call it any kind of technique particularly, but if you need a name for it, you could say it's focusing on a certain kind of geometry. So you can, if you want to, I hate labels, but if you want to put a label on it, you could say the geometric sequences. The problem with labels is that it's handy to have a label, but especially if you have lots of stuff that you need to put in drawers, and you put labels on the drawers and you know where to find things. And I mean that metaphorically, but the sad thing about labels is that people stop responding to the thing itself and respond to the labels. A good example might be somebody who's very original and acts in very unexpected ways, but fascinating. They say, oh, he's a character. And as soon as they say he's a character, they stop paying attention to the person, stop paying attention to the new thing. They say, oh, what a character. And they're responding to the label. That's why I don't like labels. I don't particularly want to be remembered for anything. My main concern is creating something. And if somebody wants to salute later, you know, fine, you know, that's great. But I'm not concerned with being remembered. The particular ones that I like are a couple paintings based on opera singers and a couple paintings based on what I call the dying minstrel, which was a theme that I first created back in 1959. And then in 2012, I've made some, we see one right here. I made some variations that are much larger and more intricate. Where does Vorpal Gallery, the name of my gallery, come from? And it comes from a poem from Alice in Wonderland. Actually, it's Alice's Further Adventures Through the Looking Glass, which is a sequel to the Alice in Wonderland. And in it, a poem is recited by Alice called Jabberwocky. It goes like this. 'Twas brillig and the slithy toves did gyre and gimble in the wabe. All mimsy were the borogoves and the mome raths outgrabe. Beware the Jabberwock, my son, the jaws that bite, the claws that catch. Beware the Jubjub bird and shun the frumious bandersnatch. He took his vorpal sword in hand. Long time the manxome foe he sought. Then rested he by a tum-tum tree and stood a while in thought. 1-2, 1-2, and through the vorpal blade went snicker-snack. He left it dead, and with its head he came galumphing back. 'Twas brillig in the slithy toves did gyre and gimble in the wabe. All mimsy were the borogoves and the mome raths outgrabe. This sort of looks like a bird, but it's a guy. Here's his face, right there, and he's looking down at her with his hand. And then you could zoom down on maybe this area of to show Alice looking up at the creature.
Okay.
Because this one we could spend a little more time on, because it's got all these beautiful translucencies and this powerful bird-shaped sort of thing.
I see what you mean.
And I even took laid some paint on and took a glass and stamped it in the paint and then made some circles on it, things. Azulau is a Portuguese word for bluebird, and it's the name of a piece composed by a Brazilian musician, composer named Jaime Ovaia, and I was playing it all the while that I was painting this painting, and it's what really inspired me, and it had all kinds of very, very subtle tones, and the actual words that are sung in Portuguese, since he's a Brazilian composer, are person singing to a bluebird and saying, please go to my beloved and tell her that life without her is worthless. I found that if I play that same music when I look at this painting, which is 6 feet by 6 feet, so it's pretty large, suddenly it's almost as if the painting starts to open up and create a depth, the music behind it. Creates an incredible sense of depth that still amazes me to look at it. So it's definitely one of my favorite paintings. This painting is called Suspended Dancer. At one time I wanted to shock people a bit and call it Garrotted Ballerina, but Suspended Dancer is really the title. Sometimes paintings get different titles. The same paintings get different titles. And I painted this for an interesting reason. I had met this lovely young woman, who intelligent and subtle and fun, but she was being killed by a relationship with a guy that she couldn't seem to get out of. It's strange, sometimes people can't get out of a relationship when they know it's no good for it. And she was dying, and so I thought, I'm gonna paint a painting of a ballerina who's beautiful, but dying. And so I used a whole lot of multiple images of the ballerina, one on top of the other, and all the way down to a sense of the ballerina who's looking like she's on tow, but she's really dangling on a rope. If you zoom in, you can see the rope under her chin and just behind her head along the top. And then if you look closely, you see that her spirit, her soul, is in the same position, but it's leaving her body. And if you look down to the leg of the ballerina, you can see the various movement, you know, like multiple exposure photographs, where you see the calf is a white stocking, and then you see the toe of the spirit, which is smaller. It's actually inside the calf and where the spirit is leaving the body, and she's already beginning to decay. If you notice, her left hand is already turning into a disappearing.
But then you realize that, oh my God, she's got a rope under her neck, and the rope, she's being hanged, and she's bouncing. That's why we have that, bouncing on the rope, dying. And here's her soul leaving her body, here's the head and her neck here, and where this arm kind of goes out and the hand down here, the soul figure, is the hand is here, and she's already going off. And then down below, the superimposition of the calf, and then even the second figure and the third figure, like here she's on tow, here it moves over, here it even changes the direction of it, you have the heel or else the front. And so this has a lot of various images superimposed on one on the other, and I've always liked this painting so much that I never would part with it.
When Burnell came back to Texas with me, and a friend who was a young painter came by, I said, listen, Goya said that if a man is falling from a third story building, you should be able to draw him before he hits the ground. So I said, I want to show you an exercise. Burnell, I want to use you as a model, and I'm going to make three poses of you, and I'm going to see if I can do each one within 5 minutes. And so this will be a 15-minute painting. And so stand still and fold your arms. So there's the one on the right, bam, bam, bam. And then, okay, now turn sideways as though you're putting your arm on a second person's hip. And bam, 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 there's the middle one. And now look like you're looking at the person whose hip the lady has put your hand on, and bam, bam, bam. And so in a flash, this painting was created. And I looked at it later and said, hey, that's a pretty good painting. I was just trying to show the young fellow that you can make a painting very, very quickly. So that's the story about this painting. This painting I did in 1959 when I fell in love with Burnell Blaine. And I was staying at the house that we were in Dallas, Texas, when I would come on the weekends. I'm hesitating because it was such an emotional time, but I asked Burnell if she would pose for me, and since we were already quite intimate, and she said she would, and I here it is. It's only 4 feet tall, but just the idea of in a certain way depicting somebody that you're totally in love with was just something that I had to do. Blood Donors, I painted it probably the early 60s, and
I had maybe even 61 or 62, I've forgotten exactly, but I saw just a little black and white shot in a newspaper of some people who had donated blood, and I thought, wow, I would like to, what a challenge to take this kind of a shot of this ordinary people and see if I could make the paint show it as spontaneously painted, freely brushed and splattered and loosely painted, and even with the suggestion of another figure, a fourth figure in the background, maybe you see the edge of them, but to show the idea of people who were very, very ordinary, very regular people, people that you would hardly look at twice, and to try to make those blues and the greens in such a way that my God, that's exciting aesthetically. And at the same time show the casualness of the cigarette in the man's hand, and he's sort of noticing somebody's looking out of the side of his eye, and this thick piece of pigment that's his ear. This painting is called Blue Sun, Green Hill. I did a whole series of abstract landscapes, some of them very, very vigorous, almost violent, some of them very tender and careful. This is one of the more tender ones for sure. You've probably seen pictures of that were taken over a period of time of sun rising. And I think that's one of the things that I've used from time to time, the idea of multiple suns sort of arising, coming up over the horizon or moving. And so we have a blue sun, a green hill, and then the suggestions maybe of a red moon preparing to emerge. This painting is called Cairo, and I painted it in very soon after I was out of college in 1957, and I was surprised that the Downey Museum of Art actually bought it. Recently I saw some pictures of streets in Cairo that were very reminiscent of this painting, so sometimes things never seem to change. Conversation, I painted it in 1961, and I wrote a little something about it. If you don't mind, I'll read you. Conversation depicts a dialogue between two personas. Persona, of course, is a term that Carl Jung was very fond of, the mask that we present to people that it's not really ourselves. So conversation depicts a dialogue between two personas, neither person caring to truly speak with the other. They let their masks do the talking. The people themselves appear rather faceless and indistinct. The man, having totally given up any attempt at true communication, turns away from the tedium, while the woman continues to observe the fruitless dialogue. Their masks, having developed more character than the people holding them, appear unaware of the situation. It's called Desert Landscape to distract you, to kind of fool you, to take your mind away from what it really is. And when its true nature is revealed to the eye and mind of the viewer, the imagined landscape completely disappears, never to be seen again. So I wanted to show somebody that you could make a painting to look like something that really wasn't what it was. And so Burnell was ironing away and popped her GE iron on the ironing board. And I said, oh, I'll paint that, but I'll see if I can make it look like a desert landscape rather than an ironing board with an old GE iron resting on it. This is an early triptych of mine. Each panel is 6 feet high, and so it spreads out to about 8 feet, 9 feet. And that's a friend of mine sitting in front of it, looking up at it. This painting was stolen from me, so I don't know where it is now. I painted it in 1967, and it's called The Voice of the Sun. And
I miss it. I'd like to find it again. Portrait of a Young Woman. It's probably one of the paintings of my own that I value the absolutely most. And it all came about in a very strange way. I had seen some paintings in an exhibition of a painter at Berkeley named James Suzuki, and I thought, these are awful, these are terrible. How can he paint such awful stuff? And then I said to myself, well, wait a minute, what's he trying to do? And I said, oh, he's trying to use dissonances, sort of like Schoenberg did in his music. And so at first it hits you hard and almost screaming, and then later you get, oh, if you keep looking, it turns into something that's just very, very spiritual and very, very floating and very, very deep. So I worked, I could do that, and I went back and did some crepe pause and said, there, I've done it. But then I thought, no, I should try and refine that a little more. And so then I spent 3 hours, and then, well, not quite enough, and then 3 days, and then 3 months, and then eventually 3 years, until I was finally satisfied with what I could actually do with complementary colors and off complementary colors, and using areas and lines to create and caress space. And when I finished this painting, I said, there, I've finally done it. Now I can get back to my abstract landscapes. And surprisingly, those 3 years gave me a whole lot more insight into what happens with color and form and light. And so the abstract landscapes then started to really sing. And that's where Descent of the Ganges and Azalao and those things came from, from this portrait of a young woman. And an interesting little story about it was that at one point reproductions were made of it. Around 1965, and maybe 15 or 20 years went by, or even longer, maybe. And one day I was sitting in a restaurant and made a drawing of somebody, and asked my friend to give the fellow the drawing. And he said, well, I'll tell him that you're a known artist so he doesn't just throw it away and think of. And so he said, oh, this is from an artist named Muldoon Elder. And the guy's little girl, she had to be no more than 5 or 6, jumps up and says, are you Muldoon Elder? I said, yeah. Did you make a painting of a woman in green and blue and red? And it was on a card that was all around. Yes, she said, our teacher told us to all go buy that card, and we have to write a poem or a story about that woman. And I said, oh my, and you recognize my name. I said, you know, you're very special. And the little girl says, oh yes, many people have told me that. So I never forgot her and did her portrait. And maybe someday that girl will find me and give me a photograph or let me see the portrait, because it was so beautiful. And I should have taken a picture of it. I said, but it was on just a paper tablecloth in the restaurant. And I just said, here, take this. There's a present for you, and you can show it to your teacher. So that's just a little extra story about that painting, but for me it was always extremely important in that whole series of portraits. Black Sun Pursuing the Red Moon is the painting that I made in 1961 when I was doing a whole series of landscapes and skyscapes, and I was really focusing in on the beauty of tones and colors and forms. And you know what paint could do when you painted with oil, but almost with a watercolor effect, with heavy pot and pastos and on the black sun and the red moon and very, very thin glazes for the sky form, you know, behind the sense of mountains. And then as you focus in and you start looking at some of the little areas of color, you see blues, one blue inside of another blue, inside of another blue, or the same way with beautiful little, for me, beautiful little seepings of yellow forms and violet forms coming through. So the idea of something powerful but also full of nuances was important in this painting. 1963, I painted Church and State, Richard Nixon and Cardinal Cushing. And what one of the things I was very, very interested in at the time was retinal after imagery, how when you looked at certain colors and shapes, the feedback of the complementary color would throb back and forth and change the work. And I thought, well, here's Richard Nixon glowing with his deviousness, and he'll even glow more as you continue to stare at that face, that the blue haze that's produced by your looking at the orange face. And the same way with Cardinal Cushing, he was the one who said, was challenged, how can the Catholic Church justify receiving mafia money? And he immediately snapped off, oh, we purify the money. So he was so clever, a person there, that I decided to have a crucifix growing out of the top of his head, and his mouth more like just a sore in his face. And then, of course, using that chartreuse against the red violet, there's the two complementary colors, each one producing the other one as you. And the whole thing is kind of satirical, I guess, and fun at the same time as trying to show some things that paint can do. The more you look at it, the more you look at the images. Blue Field is a smaller painting, only 3 feet by 3 feet, that I painted in 1967. And the imagery was not predominant. I was thinking in terms of the color and forms and shapes. And then I thought, well, what does this remind me of? Oh, it looks like a stalk of wheat or blowing in the wind. And then, why did I paint that red circle? Ah, I see, it's a morning sun just rising in a wheat field. So it was a sort of a, generally speaking, the abstract paintings that I'm working on, I'm not thinking of the theme. I'm thinking about all the color and form and tones and all the 27 different concerns that an artist should have about what's making up a painting come about. And then afterwards I say, well, now does this remind me of anything? And oh yeah, I must have had a stalk of wheat or in blowing in the wind. Figure About to Turn, I painted when I was still in the Army. If you look closely, you'll see a figure on the one hand looking over his shoulder, but then on the other hand, if you look closer, he's hunched up, and you'll notice his arm is reaching up and his hand is pressed against his face. So that has an interesting, and in the movement, you notice his left hand and his right hand seem to be in motion, where almost like a multiple exposure photograph. And of course, everybody, a lot of Italians were painting this way, starting in the practically turn of the century, well, in the 20s anyway. So if you wanted to find a label for this, you would call it futurism. Labels tend to be dismissive. So, oh, that's futurism, and then you stop looking at what's going on there. So try to avoid the label, except if you're in an art class and you need to get a point by identifying a certain kind of technique. Flamenco Dancers was a painting that I painted again while I was in the Army. I liked it so well that I never wanted to sell it, but eventually I had a chance to have my life changed, have a fabulous loft to paint and live in if I would sell it, and so I did. So it changed my life, and because having that loft just opened up all kinds of horizons for me. And I remember the woman who owned it said that when her friends would see it, they wouldn't see the male dancer for the first
couple of years that they would visit her, and finally they'd say, oh my God, look, there's a man in the background. There's his boots, there's his face, there's his arm behind his head raising up. But and I said, yeah, that's right. You know, I didn't want the eye to settle on the man for quite a while, but using the shape of the man's boot and leg actually then heightened the sense of the swirling dress that was moving about. So he was a functionary of the main figure, but I like the idea that there's always something there more than initially meets the eye. No Queen Rises is a fairly large painting, 55 inches by 40, and I painted it in 1968. And the title comes from a line in a Wallace Stevens poem called Depression Before Spring. The poem is all about a person waiting for his love to come. And it's metaphorically, the love is the first sprout that comes up in springtime that hasn't come up yet, or the first sprout on a branch, and it's still dead. Well, what is spring? Spring is the time of love and mating and procreation, and the queen, who is the person that he's awaiting, his queen, doesn't arise. The sprout doesn't happen yet. And the poem is very, very simple. It goes, the cock crows, but no queen rises. The hair of my blonde is dazzling as the spittle of cows threading the wind, ho ho. But Kiki Riki brings no Ruku, no Rukuku. But no queen comes in slipper green. In 1964, I painted poinsettias, and I decided that I'd kind of move back to being more realistic in a kind of impressionistic way. And it was looking out the bedroom window that I had as a child, where poinsettias were growing outside the window and the brown fence, and even the window would have a slight reflection bouncing off of it, of the windowsill, with kind of curtains that were there, and the fence in the background sort of reflecting itself, almost moving on along the line of where a fence would be. And I liked the idea of the vividness of the redness, and then the kind of very pale lavenders and blues of the sky. And then this dark area over here, I thought, well, it's kind of boring. And so I painted something in it that the eye could hardly see, and that would be a kind of varial vision of a Christ on the cross. And if you looked very closely, you could see his thorns and his loincloth and his arm dangling down. But it's not meant to distract you, it's just meant to kind of please me, to have something hidden in the corner, sort of like Strider, I guess, in the corner, not noticed, except by somebody who wanted to continue to look and to search.
Okay. Go ahead.
Susanna and the Elders is a drawing that I made, and it is very interesting because I had a 24-inch drawing pad that I stuck in my window to keep the mosquitoes out, because I didn't have a screen. And I came back the next day, and it had rained, and wind had sucked the drawing pad out the window, and it was in the alley behind my apartment. So I got it and dried it out and thought, well, I can use this to this warped drawing pad to just practice some drawing. So I thought, oh, I always liked this little ink sketch that was by Leonardo da Vinci and reproduced, and the original was only, I think, 5.5 inches high. So I'll just draw it out as practice. And then I kept drawing, and over the next week, I kept adding things, you know, a flower and longer hair, because it was just a simple little ink drawing, and turned it into something very different from the original Leonardo da Vinci drawing, and much bigger, and it was all in pencil. And then I decided, hey, you know, that could be Susanna and the Elders. So then I started drawing the Elders, the old evil-looking men. And then before I'd finished there, I had 17 other images in the background. And when I'd picked up the pad in the alleyway, somebody had stepped on it, and there was a huge footprint there. And so I just said, I'm going to leave the footprint, and then I'll extend it and make it kind of radiate out from the center of the drawing. So at first, you know, I wanted Susanna to be so strong that that's what caught your attention. But then if you examined it, just like the way I like to paint, there's more and more and more stuff happening all around her in the background. Interesting to create something that way, just starting out just as an exercise and then starting to take the exercise very seriously. The paper is still pretty warped, so you could probably see a kind of a rippling, but you know, here's nude. Here she is nude, Susanna up here, if you just keep looking, there's all kinds of images taking place. And if you knew the story of Susanna and the Elders, it's a wonderful biblical story. Basically, she's taking a bath and naked in the pool, and these dirty old men called the Elders say, we want you to do it with us, or we're going to tell your husband, the king, that you were being naughty elsewhere. And she wouldn't do it, so they tell the king, and the king says, well, I guess she has to die. But then, sort of like a Shakespeare story, but it's biblical, a lawyer shows up, a kind of lawyer, and I didn't call him those in those days, and cross-examines the Elders and proves that they lied. So then the king said, okay, they have to die. So Susanna is free. And Wallace Stevens wrote a beautiful, beautiful poem all about that scene. That if you look it up, if you like Wallace Stevens' poetry, you will. It's called Mononcle de Mononcle, The Monocle of My Uncle. And it's just a wonderful poem. I think you'd like it. It has a beautiful, it starts this, well, in the fifth, stanza, this luscious and impeccable fruit falls, it appears, fruit of love, fruit of life. This luscious and impeccable fruit of life falls, it appears, of its own weight to earth. When you were Eve, its acrid juice was sweet. An apple serves as well as any skull to be the book in which to read around, and is as excellent in that it is composed of what, like skulls, comes rotting back to ground. But it excels in this, that as the fruit of love, it is a book too mad to read before one reads to merely pass the time. So it talks about the danger of romantic love in that poem, and that's just a very small part of the poem. A woman showed up one time with hair like Circe, like a Greek goddess. Her name was Suzanne. So I said I had to paint her. And I thought, I have to paint, I have to show the movement of her hair, almost like she has snakes rather than hair, but it's flowing and it's not as deadly as snakes. It's just ripples and ripples. And I thought, how can I try to create? I couldn't possibly want to do something photographic, so I thought I'll use many, many different colors, reds and greens and the very charming necklace that she had wearing, just a suggestion of that, and let all the color and textures and movement try to convey the awe that I felt at seeing this woman. In the Woods is a triptych that I did, small triptychs. I've done painted huge ones, but this one, I just wanted to have the feeling of you're being in the woods, and a suggestion of maybe a lake, or maybe a pond, or maybe just some water moving, and vegetation, and just a diagonal movement through the triptych to show the connectivity of how the panels all form one image, and that diagonal, of course, then gives an implicit sense of what we call the Renaissance space, the third dimension in painting, because contemporary painters like to have the eye kind of come back to the truth that it's just a two-dimensional surface, but then there is the illusion of the third dimension. So we wanted the idea of the pulsation of third dimension existing but not existing. There's a beautiful poem that says, you are mine but not mine. And it's the same sort of thing that, you know, in that case it's the sense of I own you but I don't own you because you are independent. And so the two dimensions of the space is really independent of the third dimension. The third dimension is an illusion. And I suppose the illusion is you are mine, because whoever you are, you are not mine. But you are, if I adore you, then you are mine as well as not mine. Troubadour is a painting that I created a long time ago in a small way, and said one day I would like to recreate this painting, maybe 6 feet high, and so I finally did so, because the initial creating was in 1964, and then repainting it, but very, very differently and very vividly, only came about in 2008. And it's of a troubadour in a dark alley singing to ladies of the night, who are under a kind of blue awning. And if you look very closely at this painting, there are three ravens in the painting that one in the center, one on the side, and one large one pressed up against the troubadour. And Raven on the side is very interesting, because he becomes the black corset of a blonde lady that's looking out at the troubadour, who is being sung to, and then the background of the ladies of the night. So this painting is very, very complex, and it's painted over long period of months that I finally got around to many, many, many years after making the initial study. Tyrant is a painting that I painted in the Army in 1959, when I was working out the various ideas of the geometrical movements. And I thought, why not have somebody staring at you, and you can see his chin if you look in his eyes, and who's ready to pound on the table, and his fist is up on the top of the table, and then he starts to pound, and the arm goes down, the fist goes down, till finally it bangs on the table, the other hand resting here, and his face starts here, and then he's moving this way, and now he's looking out at you and yelling, and then at the very end we see him in the profile, and he's looking up, sort of curious to see whether all of his noise and fustian and bombast has made any effect on the viewer. So that was a painting that I had a lot of fun with, and that very, very wonderfully was loaned to the museum for the museum exhibition at the Peninsula Museum of Art, that at this moment is still going on. So if you have a chance, might be able to see it there, since I don't own it anymore. The second gallery I had was on Battery Street. It was an old warehouse that had been really fixed up in an interesting way. I started with my studio there, and then the gallery moved in. I decided that since I lost my lease in next to City Lights bookstore in the alley in 65, I would move the gallery into my studio temporarily, and it lasted there for 13 years. And here's a kind of a sense of the intimacy of the place, a giant sofa and an elevated bed where I actually slept, and Azu Lao and Voice of the Sun in the background there, as well as some pieces of sculpture. The redhead from Guatemala that feared her husband, yet nevertheless posed for art's sake, was of a redheaded woman that I saw back in 1964 in the San Francisco Zoo pushing a baby cart, and I said, "I must paint you. Would that be okay?" And she turned to her husband. He said, "Fine, that's wonderful." So they drove over to my studio, and I said, "I have to do it alone, if you don't mind." "Oh, I'm fine. I'll go in the other room." So I made this painting of her. I wanted to show the vividness of her hair, and I said, "You don't mind popping your shirt off and so forth?" And she said, "Oh no, that's fine, but don't ever show this to my husband." So I said, "Fine, and I'll never sell it either." And then later I made a second, rather different painting of her, I thought it would be interesting to have something a little less kind of almost harsh, to have something a little more soft about her. So I painted a second portrait in a very different way of her that we'll probably
this
see.
This is the second painting of the redhead from Guatemala. It's called Woman Afraid of Her Husband. She's afraid to say anything, so I sort of let the mouth almost not be there. But there was a sadness and a tenderness about her that the painting of her nude didn't convey, so I thought I would do another approach to her and also show the incredible beauty of her red hair, the way that it glistened and was so almost like sun shining on a stream, the babbling stream, or maybe the tail of a goldfish moving in such a way that had real beauty to it. The idea that I had with Woman with Green Hair was very, I guess you'd say, very painterly. The idea of okay, if we had a background that was red, or rather vermilion, red orange, and yet use the same color for the foreground of her face, and complement that against the wildness of her hair. So that was, and then the idea of whatever she's wearing, some sort of violet blouse. And also her arm being the same color, almost flat, as the background and the foreground of the face, her arm and hand reaching up to pull her hair back. And so the idea there is, here's doing something very the opposite of the delicate drawings, doing something that appears very crude, but if you keep on looking and looking and looking, you can almost get transfixed by it by looking at it over time. So it was something that a painting that I was very, very pleased with, and it was painted as a result of my being more and more aware of retinal afterimage, how the viewer's eye
actually projects colors back on the painting. And in that sense, he's actually participating in the painting, because the painting isn't just it, it's it combined with how you see it. And what happens physiologically, what happens when the viewer looks at the painting.